Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to another exciting episode of Heroes. It is episode 29, and we are just going to crack right off, start it. We got a sweaty week we got to talk about, and our regular core group is here, starting off with, we've got Robert Meyer Burnett right over here.
Good to be here, John. Good to be here, John. Thanks for having me back.
Yes, and welcome. Congratulations on winning a Geeky Award for the short film, Prelude to Axanar.
Thank you very much. It was great to see you. You were presenting at the award show. That was a great award show.
Yeah, it was really Kristen Nettepak really brings it, and she really did a great job. This third year of the Geekies was fantastic. It was the best year yet, so yay, Kristen.
The host was pretty sweaty, too.
Oh, yeah.
There was a lot of sweating.
It was a special tribute to Kevin Smith. It was a really fun time. We've also got John Campea in the house, ladies and gentlemen.
We are here, and we are live. We're actually doing this episode of Hero live, everybody. So there's already a ton of people watching live in the chat board. I'm seeing you guys talking this in the chats going. So hey, do me a favor, guys. He's got to concentrate on his notes. So if you're following me on Twitter, let's bring up my Twitter handle there just for a second. If you follow me on Twitter, if you got something you want to bring up or whatever on the show, maybe even near the end, I'll take a couple of your live things that you're saying. Just tweet it to me at John Campy, and I'll pass it on to the other guys here. Mm-hmm. And like I said, we're trying this live. It's maybe going to be a disaster. Maybe it'll just go south real fast. But we're testing it out, and we're so glad that you guys are joining us for this first live Heroes.
Yeah, so let's get this out of the way. Live right now, you can actually go to Collider Video and try to win this incredible Tyler Stout piece of art that he made for Age of Ultron. We've got a few of them. There's a grand prize winner, two runners-up. Get this piece of artwork. There were only 160 copies made, so you can win a couple of these prints if you go to Collider Video and subscribe to our channel. You can find out how to actually get your mitts on one of these amazing posters. Let's pop right off with our first bit of news. We've got Planet Hulk is going to be possibly involved in Thor Ragnarok. Now, why I say Planet Hulk is because they're talking about, you know, this is going to take place on a world that's not Asgard. It's not Midgard. It is basically a third world. And everyone keeps saying, hey, this third world could possibly be the world that the Hulk ends up getting kind of banished to, that creates Planet Hulk and World War Hulk. So Ruffalo's in his final talks to obviously be involved in Thor Ragnarok, which I like to now call Thor Planet Hulk. And it's going to take place on this new world. Thor and Hulk are going to be, like Robert actually mentioned earlier, and that's been reported, that it's going to be kind of like a Bob Hope, Bing Crosby road trip movie, where they kind of, maybe Thor goes over to where Planet Hulk is hanging out, and he, you know, they fight for a minute, then they become pals. Maybe the Valkyries, and specifically Valkyrie, who's in the Defenders for the original ones.
Right.
So there's a lot of talk about they're going to be introducing these kind of characters in the film, and let alone, It's called Thor Ragnarok, which means a little friend of ours called Surtur might be showing up, who's got to pull that sword, yo. So let's talk about this. What do you think about the Hulk being added to Thor?
Well, I think it's great. First of all, I just want to point out that the Hot Toys Avengers Age of Ultron Hulk with the Hulk smashed torso has just shipped. Just wanted to point that out. I think it's great because, you know, first of all, it's also a way to spin off. You can't do Avengers movies with this cast all the time.
Right.
They're eventually going to be priced out of, I heard it's going to cost $400 million just to pay for the talent in Infinity War.
I can't believe that's true.
$400 million for both movies because of what they have to pay.
True.
But you think about how many people are going to be in it. I mean, if you're going to have the Guardians of the Galaxy, you're going to be in it. You're going to have all the core cast is going to be in it. The Robert Downey Jr., what he gets to pay. But if they do a Planet Hulk movie, you've got Ruffalo can be in it, but you've got a whole new cast of characters, and you can pay Ruffalo for working half the shoot days because the other half the shoot days are the Hulk. So I think it's a really cool way to sort of, I'd love to see three Planet Hulk movies. I love that storyline. I have the hardcover omnibuses, as a matter of fact. And the Hulk had a son. You know, it's all good. I mean, bring it on. And Hope and Crosby, first of all, Ruffalo and Thor together. I mean, you've got Chris Hemsworth. That's going to be a great, I want to see them go at it.
Yeah.
And of course, they had the best comedic moment in the first Avengers. You know, when the Hulk smashes Thor. I mean, they're just a funny bunch of dudes. I want to see that movie.
How about you, John?
I think it makes sense. I think it makes absolute sense. Look, and it's no, you know, secret, no surprise that, oh, the two big guys who aren't in Captain America Civil War. The only two guys who aren't in Captain America Civil War. I think Laurel and Hardy are in Captain America Civil War. The only two guys who are not there, they're going to be paired up in the next one. And I love it because I don't know that there's two characters. I love seeing Cap and Tony together. I do. But I don't think there's two characters that I love seeing together more than Hulk and Thor. When they're fighting each other, or when they're fighting side by side. There's something really cool in that. And I think you bring Loki into it as well, which I think we're all expecting Loki's going to pop up in there, yeah. Although Tom Hiddleston is still playing Quay. Oh, I don't know yet if I'm going to be in it. Yeah, you know you're going to be in it. Yeah. I think it sounds great. Now, this other world stuff, will they do Planet Hulk? We've talked about this before. I don't think right. so. But that doesn't mean you can't take elements of Planet Hulk. You can cherry pick whatever elements you want and just pluck them out and put them in there and see how well those work. I think there might be some of that going on. So I think this gives, you know, Marvel and its cinematic universe license to explore more on the galactic front that we mm-hmm. got into with Guardians of the Galaxy. I think it gives us time to explore the dynamic and the relationship between Thor and Hulk at the same time. These are the two biggest badasses in the Avengers.
Yeah.
It's Thor and Hulk. And them doing stuff together, I think I'm looking forward to it more than Captain America Civil War.
Really?
And I'm really looking forward to Captain America Civil War.
Yeah, them some big words.
But now that you're announcing this, I might actually be looking forward wow. to this more. What about you?
I am really looking forward to it. I love the idea of Thor Ragnarok because the way Lee and Kirby did those issues back in the 60s with the Mangog. Like, bring forth the Mangog. I want to see that. And then I want to see Walt Simonson's take on the very same thing where he had the doom, doom, doom. The guy bringing forth the legion of creatures to attack and destroy the universe. Only Thor and Beta Ray Bill could stop them.
Well, that's what I want to see. I want to see Beta Ray Bill.
I want to see, but could it be too much? And like, I'm like, no. Maybe not, because Civil no. War has 700 characters in it. Yeah, I just want a third dude. I want Beta Ray Bill.
Somebody in the live chat board here, and I am looking at the live chat board, by the way. Matthew in the live chat board says, call it Thor Ragnarok straight out of Asgard.
Damn.
There you go.
Like straight out of Asgard. They just added the Hulk, yo. All right, so check it out. Let's move on to number two. We've got Hellfire Club and Legion come to the TV via Marvel and Fox, friends again. Fox has got two X-Men television series moving forward. They're somewhat offbeat picks to me. One is based on Professor Xavier's son, David Haller, called Legion, while the other focuses on the X-Men's villainous super team named the Hellfire Club, last seen in the X-Men movie First Class. Right. Let's talk a little bit about this. Like, so the development of Marvel characters and superhero characters on television has obviously just escalated. We've got DC's already got, I think, five shows now. They have Arrow, The Flash, Legends of Tomorrow, Supergirl, and they had Constantine. They're going to replace it with something else. But
Gotham,
they have already got five right there. So, and it seems like there's no stopping DC in the television universe. Marvel was a little bit slower, but their universes are binded together. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., things that happen in the Marvel movie world, kind of set the tone for what the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. series are going to be about. And then they also have another spinoff of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which is Agent Carter. So right now they've had pretty much those two television shows up to now. And that's Marvel proper, Marvel via through Disney. Now, these two shows are being made by Fox, who own all of the mutant characters. So that, you know, I think, you know, all of us, I remember reading last week, like, everybody's, looks like Fantastic Four has been traded. You know, I don't even know who starts these weird rumors. They're like, is it true? That'd be great, but I don't know. I don't think that's going to happen. So that's not happening as far as we haven't heard officially. But what we did hear officially is Legion and Hellfire Club, which are really kind of weirder choices, at least to me, than even making a Gambit movie. What do you think, Robert?
Well, I think I always loved the Hellfire Club.
Sure.
And I thought, you know, Brian talked about if he was going to do X-Men 3, he wanted the Hellfire Club to be the villains. That's kind of why I think they made it into First Class,
because sure.
he worked on the story and was a producer on that. But Legion, I don't know if I've ever liked Legion as a character. I mean, I love the X universe, mm-hmm. and it's so rich, but it's not like he's really a hero. You know, Legion was always kind of a pain in the ass when he'd show up. So how do you do a series around him? Is he going to be some crazy kid who can't control his powers that, you know, he's on Ritalin or something and he's going to stand in for over-medicated children around the world?
Probably.
I don't know what that's going to be like. But the Hellfire Club, bring that on. I mean, I'd love to see like some nefarious group of people, nefarious mutants that have a worldwide network of they'd be kind of like great Bond villains, you know, and I'd love to see that. I mean, especially if they have the whole, they keep the pantheon, you know, you've got the Black King and you've got, I mean, I guess Emma Frost is dead though, so she can't really be in it.
No one's ever dead.
Although they, you know, they did change the timeline, although she did die before Days of Future Past.
Right. I mean,
didn't she die in Wolverine or...
Well, Emma Frost doesn't even count.
Oh,
the Wolverine Origins one is like, oh, that's a different mutant timeline.
That's a, that's a totally different mutant timeline because she, Magneto says in Days of Future Past, Emma is one of the people that died. Clearly, he was upset about that. So,
right.
I don't know. I mean, I think the Hellfire Club, bring it on. What a cool TV show title. The Hellfire Club.
Yeah. I don't know.
But
if
it should be an HBO show.
Right.
If I want to see. Or FX.
Yeah,
put it on FX.
Get a little more extreme Hellfire. I don't know if they're going to actually stick with anything that has happened in the films, because First Class definitely had that Bond-style Hellfire Club, Kevin Bacon and all those characters. But I think with this version of the Hellfire Club, my guess would be that it's going to take place now, and it's going to be a different kind of Hellfire Club.
They could make it like Empire. You know how Empire is one of the most successful shows ever on television? Maybe it's going to be their version of Empire. It just won't be a record company. There'll be like a multinational arms
crime
dealer.
Family.
Yeah, something like that.
It could run that way.
It could
way.
Be like The Godfather, except for the modern day with mutants.
I think with Legion, I think they're not going to make him so crazy and weird. I mean, when I think of Legion, I always think of Bill Sienkiewicz's artwork.
Me too.
That's from New Mutants. That's exactly when I hear that, I see him with the weird hidden play hairstyle.
Yes.
You know what I mean? It's like straight out of the 80s is what it is. And but it's fun. It's amazingly cool artwork, and you know, you don't know who Bill Sienkiewicz is, look him up. He's one of the greatest artists on the planet.
One of my
favorite
comic artists of all time, and his New Mutants run with the Demon Bear storyline.
And shall we mention his Moon Knight run? So Legion, I don't think they're gonna rock it that way. I think they're gonna go more like, you know, loner kid with strange powers, you know, but he's got some secrets, and you know, some, maybe a couple mentors will help him out, like figure out what he's going to do with his powers.
But don't you think it's weird that somebody said, yeah, well, let's do a Legion TV show?
Very weird.
Like, where who came up with that?
I have no idea.
It depends on how you're going to set it up, because look, Legion, first of all, my bias. Legion will always have a special place in my heart because Legion is the one that kicks off my all-time favorite storyline series in comics, which was the Age of Apocalypse. Mm-hmm. There's no start. Legion, who's really kind of crazy and extremely powerful, he's like, and he's the son of Professor Charles Xavier, by the way, just in case you didn't know that. And he's like, I want to do something good for my dad. And he decides, well, how am I going to do it? I'm going to go back in time and kill the guy that gives him all these problems. I'm going to go back and kill Magneto. So he goes back in time when Charles and Eric were really good friends. He goes, I'm going to save Magneto. I'm going to kill him. And he tries to kill him, except Charles is a really good buddy. He goes, I got to save Magneto. So he jumps in front, and Legion ends up killing Charles Xavier, which screws up the timeline, and that sets up Age of Apocalypse, which is really cool, and it's my favorite storyline of all time. I think there's something very cool you can do.
Do you like the Sugar Man?
I was iffy on him.
MODOK. That's it. I don't need another.
Sugar Man was.
There's only one MODOK.
I keep telling Brian Singer, like, dude, you got to put Sugar Man in the movies.
And I'm glad Brian Singer says you're insane, right? When you say
oh,
that.
He does. He does.
But the way I think Legion could work is, if you've got a character, it would depend on what the context of the show would be and what you built around, what other major characters you have around him. But if you have this like really tortured soul of a dude with that kind of power that he has, you'd have to have another main character that almost becomes Legion's bridge or his anchor to reality or something. You could have something really special there, I think. Like if you want to go like in a dark tone, like a Hannibal or something like that.
Well, that would be great.
You do something really cool with Legion. Yeah. But I agree. Hellfire Club sounds, I was going to swear, it sounds really cool.
It does.
Like you could do so much. There's so many doors that open to you if you do a Hellfire Club. So I like both the ideas.
Yeah. The thing is, who wouldn't want to be a member?
Everyone
would. Like, you know, the old saying that I wouldn't want to be the member of a club of anyone that would have me,
that would
as,
have
a member.
Me as a member.
But I would want to be a member of the Hellfire Club. When I was reading X-Men comics in the 80s when I was a teenager, I'm like, I don't want to join the X-Men. I want to join the Hellfire Club.
That's right. Sebastian Shaw's kind of a jerk, but I'll hang out with him for a while.
Man.
I'll do the dishes for at least a year.
The Hellfire Club has a sex parties.
So it's theirs to screw up. I think it's like a lot of people are very interested in seeing the Hellfire Club. Any of the sweaties read comics or know about it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's even, it's set a precedent. It was already part of First Class. So it's already in the, you know, the movie sphere. So here we go to TV. I'm way interested in seeing what they do with Legion. You know, I'll watch the first
one. Can I bring this up? I should say this because I have crap talked the TV show Gotham. You mentioned Gotham. Mm-hmm. I have crap talked the show Gotham because it deserved to be crap talked. The first season was terrible. But I had a bunch of people been tweeting me recently saying, John, give season two a shot. You might be impressed. So the other day I was sick at home, had a lot of time to kill. There were four episodes on Hulu at the time. I watched them. And I got to say, those of you who were tweeting me, you were right. It is an improvement. Season two of Gotham, I just want to throw that out there, is an improvement over season one. I think it's a significant improvement.
Wow,
to the point now that I'm like, when does the next episode come on?
Really?
And if you had said that to me 6 months ago, that I'd be like, when is the next episode of Gotham? I would have said, you're crazy, but I'm actually there now. So I've been talking to Dennis about it because Dennis hates that show so much. And I watched the farm. I'm talking to Dennis like, Dennis, seriously, like season two is actually pretty good. So,
like, what would you say to a person who's mainly a Batman fan? Because Gotham is like this weird world that Batman doesn't exist yet.
Yeah, forget it. Just put Batman out of your head entirely. Just put it out. And I find that, you know, you've got a young Bruce Wayne character in there, and they do some pretty cool little illusion stuff. But really, the guy who plays Gordon, even in season one, which I didn't like, he's really good, and it's a really good character. The James Gordon character is a really good character on the show, even was in the bad season.
Does he make you forget the OC?
Yes. Okay. Yes, he does. Just completely makes me forget the OC. But I would encourage anybody who gave up on Gotham in season one, like me, give season two a shot. It's actually been a nice, pleasant surprise for me.
All right, because I haven't watched season two. I'll watch it.
Yeah, I haven't watched it either. I'll give it a shot. There's like going to be five episodes. I could rock those and talk about it next week. All right, let's move on to something. It's a small story, this next one. I was almost not going to include it in the Heroes because it barely made a dent in anything. It's the Star Wars trailer that all of us watched a million times. It debuted last night.
There are Star Wars comic books.
We are lucky. The internet is still around. It broke the internet for several hours. All Fandango, all the different sites that, you know, you could buy tickets on, all crashed. We were lucky enough to actually get tickets. Thank you, Dennis and Wendy. They were actually on it literally a minute before all the sites broke. So we actually got our tickets.
Yeah, me too. I got my tickets. I'm very excited.
Yeah, very, very happy that we're going to be able to see it. And I'm sure many millions of other people, because, John, you were telling us that Variety announced that it sold 8 times the amount of the biggest selling movie of all time, The Hunger Games.
Yeah,
Previous record for the most tickets sold in one day was the last Hunger Games movie. And Variety's now reporting that Star Wars Force Awakens sold not twice as much, not 3 times as much, sold 8 times as many as the previous record holder. I can't even wrap my head around that.
Yeah, that's insane numbers. So, you know, anybody who's looking forward to this small, tiny film, Star Wars The Force Awakens, you're going to have to wait a while.
Each little indie film you might have heard of.
Yeah, so.
But like in the comics, do you think we're going to see Jackson or the Hoojibs?
I don't know. You know, it was funny. I bring this up mainly because we all saw it yesterday. It was like a really fun experience. If you haven't seen it yet, I know you've already seen it, but I'm going to say, if you haven't seen it, you should definitely watch this Star Wars trailer because it's fantastic. And it really made me so happy to see them taking over the Star Wars franchise and actually changing it enough to make it new. And for all the people who are old enough, like all of us on this at this table, all enjoyed the original Star Wars when we were young kids. And now to see Han Solo back in the film, like 35 years later, it's like a magician's trick.
Yeah.
And he's saying, everything that you ever heard about the dark side and the Jedi, it's all true. While they're showing amazing, incredible special effects of the Millennium Falcon avoiding TIE fighters. It's the Millennium Falcon in hyperspace inside that weird, like super blue, weird, you know, hyperspace.
But it looked like the super blue, weird hyperspace
from the original Star Wars. That's what made me so incredibly happy is those little moments that I was like, I'm so happy they're adding that little moment.
Well, I have to tell you though, I loved it. I watched it like 50 times, but I'm going to be a little bit of a contrarian. It looked to me like we're getting a remake of A New Hope. Mm-hmm. Like to the point of you've got Supreme Leader Snoke that we haven't seen, who's the Emperor.
Right.
You've got Domhnall Gleeson playing Tarkin. You've got Kylo Ren is Vader. Mm-hmm. You know, we open up with a desert planet. Why does it have to be a desert planet? Why couldn't it have been a different planet? You've got Daisy Ridley is Luke. Mm-hmm. John Boyega is Han. Mm-hmm. Then Han Solo is Obi-Wan Kenobi. Mm-hmm. And it ends destroying a gigantic, or if they destroy it, a gigantic, massive base on a planet, Starkiller Base. Mm-hmm. I mean, it literally looks like we're getting Star Wars Greatest Hits. Mm-hmm. And the plot, which sort of became more apparent from that trailer. Now, is that a bad thing? Maybe not. I don't think so. I mean, it depends really how they set up the characters and what they want. Where's the, my thing is, I love the idea that Kylo Ren is a Vader. He's basically leading a Vader cover band.
Right.
You know, he's got a Vader cover band. He wants to win that Vader Grammy. You know, I'm going to finish what you start. Does that mean you want to bring back the Sith? Because the Sith are gone. That's why nobody knows about the Jedi and the Sith anymore, because they've really been eradicated.
Right.
Who knows? Because if Luke was the last Jedi and he's gone, clearly he's gone somewhere, mm-hmm. and no one believes it anymore, which is interesting, because in Star Wars, everybody knew about the Jedi and just, pshaw, the Jedi. You know, when that great, when your fire is all that is gone out of, their fire has gone out of the universe, you're all that's left of that order.
Right.
You know, now if there's no one left at all, it's Kylo Ren's job to bring back the Force.
Right.
Maybe that's what's going on. That's interesting to me. And I was very interested and intrigued by that. He's a Vader groupie.
Well, I would say J.J. Abrams already did a remake of Star Wars. It's called Star Trek. Like, so the very first Star
Trek.
You had
to bring that up.
The very first Star Trek is basically the same storyline of the very first Star Wars. Kirk was basically Luke on a desert planet when he went to visit that little base, and Pike was basically Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Right.
So we could go into it and say, you know, there's the story elements of the first Star Trek were just basically Star Wars draped over it, because he loved Star Wars so much back when he was doing Star Trek. So now that he's actually doing Star Trek, now that he's actually doing Star Wars, I think they definitely there's elements of those of that plot that are in there, but I don't think it's going to go note for note. I specifically know that I think the Starkiller base is going to, you know, be different than just being a planet destroying base.
Right, it looks like
a larger destroying, you know, unit of destruction. But I don't think it's going to go down the same way where we've got to get these, you know, the resistance is the rebels, and it ends with them.
No.
I think there's going to be story elements that are all have that familiarity to Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi, and less so the prequels.
I will say this. I love all these new characters. I don't even know what they do or really. I love them. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. I love John Boyega. I love Daisy Ridley.
Mm-hmm.
She's amazing. And I love how Domhnall Gleeson looks. He looks cooler than Tarkin looked with his black outfit. I mean, they really nailed the Imperial outfits in this. We haven't seen Supreme Leader Snoke. I can't imagine. And Lupita Nyong'o, you hear her voice, but you don't see her. I think it looks phenomenal. I mean, it's the kind of movie we all wanted to get with the prequels.
Right.
You know, now we're getting it. And you can tell, I mean, it's filmed with modern techniques. There's a lot of sweeping camera moves because Star Wars is very classically photographed.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of dynamic photography going on, both in the effects sequences and in the live action stuff. And it really... I got my blood boiling, kind of like the first time I kissed a girl.
There's like a tip of the hat to a lot of the homages that JJ is able to fit in there. Like the Millennium Falcon coming towards the camera is right out of the Empire Strikes Back asteroid chase. Before I get into the comic book aspect of this, John, what would you like to say about the trailer?
It's awesome. It's great. I think it was the best of the three trailers. I don't think it was the best trailer of the year. I'll still give that mantle to Batman v Superman. I still think that was the best trailer of the year. But Star Wars Force Awakens will be a better movie than Batman v Superman. That I have no doubt. And you know, I've talked so much about this trailer in the past 24 hours on our live reaction we did.
That's right.
On our 45-minute Jedi Council that we did on Movie Talk this morning. So. Bottom line, I thought it was awesome. I thought it did everything it needed to do. I thought it was the perfect Star Wars trailer for this new thing. Showed us just enough, didn't show us too much. Super excited about it.
So let's talk about the comics. For myself, as a little kid, when Star Wars came out, they had already done a few kinds of adaptations of movies to comics. I remember Logan's Run.
Yeah, I have those.
Yeah, so there was a few other, like, I can't remember if they did a Jaws comic because that was 1975. I can't remember. But for Star Wars... they did a comic book adaptation. Howard Chaykin drew it. Archie Goodwin did the scripting of it, I'm pretty sure. Correct me if I'm wrong online. We can find out. But I remember they did issues 1 through 6 was basically Star Wars.
Yeah.
And then came issue 7. And you're like, oh, my God, they're continuing Star Wars. Like, no one really knew what was going to happen with Star Wars. We didn't know that there was going to be a thing called The Empire Strikes Back, which sounded weird when I first heard the title.
They didn't know they were going to have a...
They didn't know. They had the Star Wars Holiday Christmas special. Remember that, kids? So they didn't know what the hell they were doing yet. And they were like, yeah, just go ahead and make those comics. And Han Solo was, like, teamed up with a weird green bunny. Remember that character?
It's Jackson, right?
Okay, yeah. I mean... You, if you don't know what I'm talking about, this is very much worth, you know, go online, buy the comic, go to Comixology, buy whatever you digital comics you can of the original early Star Wars. Just buy a couple of them. Just
they
to
just
check
released
it out.
An omnibus, actually. Oh, okay. There's a beautiful hardcover Marvel omnibus of the original that includes the adaptation of the movie.
Excellent.
And then the continuing.
I highly recommend it. I bought the omnibus that had, like, I think it was issues 42 to 64 or something, because that was dealing with Boba Fett before any of the weird clone stuff. So I kind of like that Mandalorian army style version of Boba Fett.
There's a lot of really cool stuff in that first Marvel run of Star Wars before Dark Horse took over the franchise.
Incredible artwork, too, in the middle run was done by Al Williamson.
Right.
Who he did the adaptation of The Empire Strikes Back. And the
Amazing
adaptation, which had some of his own just kind of weird art stylings and then mixed in with, like, I love those comics that were adaptations of movies that took, you know, the characters actually looked like the characters from the film. They used actual really good, you know, draftsmen to do the you know, the spacecrafts and whatnot. But then once they moved on into what was not the movie anymore, they kept that kind of look, which was really exciting. And they were able to do that for, like, I'd say maybe 12 or 15 issues. My point is, I wonder now with, you know, Star Wars, what it is now, like a global phenomenon. Back then it wasn't. They didn't even know what a sequel really are. Are we going to make a sequel to this thing? They didn't have that figured out yet. Really, sequels back then were not like what we expect now. Now we want sequels to just regular anything. I wonder if there's going to be a sequel to this movie. It's like movies were just movies. And now everything is a sequel. So with this Star Wars, they've built their you know, their production pipeline quite smart. They built out all the comic books. They have like four different amazing comic books.
And they're all canon.
I think they have more than four,
right? But I mean, I'm just saying they're all canon. And there's like Star Wars Shattered Empire, which is basically takes place between Return of the Jedi and Force Awakens, so to fill in the gap, so to speak. They have a Darth Vader comic. They have Star Wars proper. So they have so many different comics. If you guys haven't checked it out, I know Christian on Jedi Council goes through every single comic book every week. He gives you a little update on it. So definitely check that out for the Star Wars comic book information. But I'm saying check it out. I'm really excited to see what they do after Force Awakens.
It's going to be interesting because they know episode 8 is already in production.
Yes.
And you've got Rogue One. I mean, I never thought we'd live in a world where we're going to get a Star Wars movie every year and then canon books and comics to sort of fill in the blanks. Yeah. And somebody's thinking about it.
Yeah, tying like it all in.
It's all tied together. Very, very exciting.
And it's nice to know, like, that we don't have to wait so many years for episode 8 and episode 9, so that whatever they're going to do to cover those 12 to 24 issue story arcs can actually be done to fit in properly with the movies.
Right. So I just hope I don't get hit by a bus in the next 2 months.
Yeah, no kidding.
All right. All right. So call off the hit. Call off the hit.
Please, just let me live until the end of December.
All right. Let's move on to something that probably nobody knows about. It's a comic book called Why the Last Man. So, and it's headed to FX. So FX is developing Why the Last Man. It's being developed by the comic creator himself, Brian K. Vaughan, an incredible writer. He's written a lot of amazing things, as well as writing Why the Last Man. This dystopian science fiction series is about the last man on Earth who can actually still procreate and make babies. So let's talk about it, Robert. What do you think?
I love the series. You know, again, I was a series that I have every issue, and then when it came out as a deluxe hardcover from DC, I had to get all the hardcovers. I think there's 5 total. Yep. I mean, what a really interesting show or it's going to be. I mean, you know, the Amazon characters that, like, remove one of their breasts, and the women fuck up the world just as much as the men do in the comic, and I think it's great. And of course, he has a pet monkey, Ampersand. And, you know, anybody who has a pet monkey is okay. Not since BJ and the Bear has a TV show excited me, because you're going to have a pet monkey. And I hope it's a real monkey, not a CG monkey.
I'm sure it'll be a real monkey.
It's got to be a real monkey.
One thing is that's not going to be involved is Shia LaBeouf, because I remember for a few years they were talking about Why the Last Man as a movie.
Right.
And Shia LaBeouf was attached.
It was
going to
it was Shia LaBeouf was on to star for a number of years. DJ Caruso,
right,
who directed Shia in movies like Suburbia and Eagle Eye, both of which I thought were pretty good. They were both attached for about 3 years to direct and do it. And I'll be honest with you, I still think that would be a hell of a movie. Look, is Shia LaBeouf a little bit of a nut job? Yeah. But if you didn't see, what was that tank war movie with Brad Pitt? That Shia
Fury.
Fury. If you didn't see Fury, if you don't forget all the publicity surrounding Shia. If you don't know that he is a world-class actor, like, forget whatever else you might think about him. If you don't think he's a world-class actor, you simply don't know what you're talking about. This dude is stupid talented.
He really is.
Maybe also stupid, period. but he is stupid talented. And I'll be honest with you. I would have been really... I was looking forward to that DJ Caruso, Shia LaBeouf rendition. I thought it would have been really cool. But it might work better as a television series.
I think it'll work better as a television series. Just like Preacher works better as a television series. If you're...
Walking Dead. I mean, if you look to Walking Dead as an example of... You've got a multi-part storyline. They're using the comics to draw from. I mean, if Vaughn is really... He can use his story. The entire comic run will run, what, 5, 6, 7 seasons? He can draw that
at the very least 5 seasons. If they want to stretch, they could do 7. So, which is great. So hopefully that all works. And I'm really gunning for Preacher. I cannot wait to see... Preacher. It's going to be on AMC. It's being developed by Seth Rogen, who's a super sweaty for this project. I love it when I hear that, like, the right people have the controls of the project or the property that you love. So I'm really looking forward to... I've already seen what Arseface looks like.
Have you?
Yeah. I mean, if you go online, you can find it. So it's somewhere. I'm not going to tell you where.
I can't believe they're even going to have that character.
Isn't that awesome?
I just want the Saint of All Killers. I want Cassidy.
Kids,
I want
those
one shots.
Don't shoot your face off with a shotgun. It's going to be a disclaimer in every episode.
Preacher is going to be... We'll do a special Heroes just when Preacher finally comes out.
Half of America is going to go
nuts. Let's talk about some rumor time. We're going to rumors. Let's talk about, is OMAC going to be the big bad for Batman v Superman? So we've got OMAC, which the picture there you see is from a Keith Giffen attempt at rebooting OMAC. I'll give you a little background. Rumors are bouncing all around the web. Started by a special effects artist who said Doomsday isn't in the final finished film. He said, Doomsday didn't make it into any of the effects that we did. Whether he's lying or whether it's true, many people online are now looking for clues. Like, if it's not Doomsday, then who is it? Who's going to be the main villain? If it's not just Lex Luthor saying the red capes are coming, they might be in... The answers might be in the LexCorp website. So is OMAC a fully operational device, which is sort of like a, you know, what OMAC is from the Jack Kirby comics?
I was going to say one man army corps.
Yeah, one man army corps. He's this dude with a mohawk. He's controlled by Brother Eye. He's like this super weapon that, just sort of like Shazam, there's this little kid who's like, I can't remember when, I can't even remember the kid's name. I think it's Billy Drake or something like that. Billy,
I used
maybe.
To love OMAC, though.
OMAC is amazing and fun.
And when they first announced that they were bringing it back, like in Justice League, I was like, wait a minute. They're going to bring back OMAC? And then they turn it into something really cool.
Yeah, these giant, weird blue robots with, like, laser eyes.
And initially, weren't they more like... Wasn't OMAC, like, more like Skynet in a way? Like a Skynet
Skynet, it's basically Brother Eye with this one satellite that kind of, you know, could oversee and control everything. And then they incorporated that into the OMAC project, which I think is kind of buried within the Lex Luthor website. If there's little clues that you can pick out that are...
And then Batman sort of took it over.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what happens in the movie. But I like, actually, when I heard that, I was like, I'm all for Doomsday not being in this movie and all for OMAC being the big bad.
Well, especially if Bruce Wayne has been keeping tabs on all these metahumans using the OMAC system.
Right.
You know, maybe he had something to do with it. Maybe Lex Luthor did. I don't know. But I think it'd be great if it was Bruce Wayne because of what happened in Metropolis with Zod.
Yes, and I truly wonder now that with all those little elements from Man of Steel seeping into Batman v Superman, Lex Luthor obviously has kryptonite. They showed it in the trailer. He's also got Zod. They showed that in the trailer.
He's got the corpse of Zod,
So is Brainiac far behind? Is Brainiac, who is actually, you know, if you look just into Man of Steel, obviously what was controlling those birthing units is probably a creature that will be then called Brainiac when they unlock the codex?
The codex.
Yeah, so all those things are going to figure in somehow. I don't know if they're going to figure it all into this script of Batman v Superman, but that's some heavy stuff that's already just there. It's
on
the table.
Well, then if they're going to ride into Justice League, I mean, all this could be part of the Justice League's OMAC and Brainiac. Who knows?
What do you think about OMAC, John?
I think it's a plausible possibility because, look, when you're... One of the struggles and challenges you're always going to have with a Superman character is who fights Superman.
Yeah.
That's always going to be one of the big challenges. So who fights Superman? Batman can fight Superman. As ridiculous as that sounds, if you read the comics, there's a lot of precedence for it.
Right.
So then, all right. Who do you fight Batman and Superman and apparently Wonder Woman? Right. What do you do? Now your list, your rogues gallery starts to do this. It gets small. It's like, right. Who can we pick out? OMAC is one of those feasible characters. And once again, this is a lot like we were talking about Planet Hulk. You don't have to use Planet Hulk, but you can cherry pick elements of Planet Hulk out. They may have a character in here who may not be called OMAC, but they may be drawing characteristics of OMAC out and putting together some supervillain. I will be very relieved if it's not Doomsday, because I think Doomsday is a bullet you keep in your chamber for later. You don't blow it on the first film out. I think you save him for later. I think there's a lot you can do with the Doomsday. So if anything, I'll just be happy if it's not Doomsday and they don't call him Doomsday.
Right. Well, I kind of like, it was Final Crisis that had the OMAC army sort of take over the Earth using the anti-life equation. I don't really know what happened in Final Crisis. I keep trying to read it once a year to see exactly what happened.
Yeah, I gave up a long time ago.
It was kind of cool.
My Final Crisis is what I'm going to have for dinner. That's what I think every day. That's my Final Crisis.
I call that the Great Dilemma.
Yeah. Well, let's move on to a thing I like to call Minor Mutations, where we're just going to pick off a whole bunch of cool news of the week, and then we're just going to chat about it. So first off, in Minor Mutations, you might see from the kind of grayed out area, who is that? Yes, it's Gambit, and it's Doug Liman. He's in talks to actually direct Gambit, and he's a great director. So number two, we've got Seth Rogen. He wants to make The Boys as a series. The Boys. I think we've talked about it. If you don't know what The Boys are, get with it. It's incredible. Adam McKay was trying to make it as a movie. That didn't work out. Now Seth Rogen, the guy who just made Preacher, that's happening. Seth Rogen's our man. Come on, Seth, make The Boys a series. I'm with you. I will watch every single episode and get at least three other sweaties to
Unless
watch it with
Preacher
me.
Preacher sucks.
I know. Well, Preacher will not suck. Seth Rogen has told me himself personally in my dreams.
He also told me that about Green Hornet.
Oh, no, come on. I'm not giving up on him. All right, number three, we've got Topher Grace. He loves Spider-Man. So Spider-Man number three is what we're talking about. Remember Topher Grace played Venom? He says it made a lot of money, and he loves Sam Raimi. So, and he knows, he's very painfully aware that people hate it and complain. He's like, a lot of people weren't so happy with it, is kind of his way of saying that. And finally, we've got Fox saying Captain America. Oh, we've got two more. Captain America is un-American. Fox and Friends, the stupidest channel on the planet. Why would you even be surprised if they would say something idiotic like that? I just had to throw this in because I hate them. So, and then finally, our final news of note is Batman v Superman from 1949. It's an incredible, amazing, fun trailer cut together from scenes of Lewis Wilson and as playing Batman and Kirk Allen playing he was the original Superman. So they used this footage, this black and white footage of them basically having to fight each other, and like Superman's a, you know, like kind of redoing some newspaper, because it's really, really, really well done. I don't know if you guys got a chance to watch it. 49 version. It's a lot of fun. Whoever made that, kudos to you. What else pops off to you guys as far as Minor Mutations?
The one that stands out to me the most is the Doug Liman possibly directing Gambit. Now this is coming out of Deadline.
Right.
Look, when you got the guy who directed Mr. and Mrs. Smith, which is, if you haven't watched that in a while, go back and watch Mr. and Mrs. Smith. It is a really fun, great little action film. The guy who directed Edge of Tomorrow.
Live, Die, Repeat for all you people.
Yeah, Live, Die, Repeat.
No, all you need is Kill. Get it right, sweaties.
That's right.
All that.
Which, by the way, I have the Japanese steelbook.
Oh, very
And it's
cool.
All You Need is Kill.
Oh,
very
sweet.
Nice. That's what the title of the movie was in Japan.
Man, that's awesome. That was going to be the original name of the movie, too, and then they changed it to something stupid. Anyway, this guy directing Gambit. I think this would be nothing but good news for Gambit. Mm-hmm. I think this brings our expectations. I already think Gambit has a chance of being pretty good. This takes it that from, I think it has a chance to be a really good film if you got a director like this on board.
And Liman also directed the first Bourne movie.
Yes, you the know, first Bourne Identity. And, yes, and the first Bourne.
And I think the guy, I mean, I think Live, Die, Repeat, Edge of Tomorrow, All You Need Is Kill is one of the finest genre films of the last 10 years.
So good.
It is so good. And I don't understand how nobody got how it was the first gamer movie. The whole thing was about how to play games, where you go and you figure out how to play a level.
You screw up, start over.
I mean, I don't think it connected with people on that way. I would have thought the youth of America would have embraced it. Everybody would have seen it. But if it was called All You Need Is Kill, they might have. But the direction in that film was great. He also directed Jumper.
Yep.
Remember that? I know.
I was in Jumper.
Oh, you were?
I'm an extra in three scenes in Jumper.
Are you really?
Yes.
Now, that movie was not great, but it was really interesting.
No, it was not great.
And it was worth... His direction's great. I can't
wait for
this.
He also started out in the business doing directing Swingers with Jon Favreau. Swingers. So he's been in it for a while. I think I agree with you. Edge of Tomorrow's Kill, Repeat, whatever, however you want to call it. It's a fantastic science fiction film that was destroyed by its marketing campaign and the dumb song. Whatever that stupid song. Oh, I don't even remember it anymore.
This is not the end.
That's right.
It's like it was so
It just really murdered by its marketing campaign, just like John Carter was. So it's one of those films that is like really worth seeing.
No, John Carter was killed intentionally by Bob Iger, who knew that there was a possibility Disney was going to be able to get Star Wars. And he didn't want George Lucas to go, wait a minute, you're developing John Carter and you're going to make multiple John Carter movies for $250 million, which was an influence on Star Wars. And if you're doing that, maybe I should go to someone else to buy Star Wars. That's my theory.
All right. Well, I'm not going to argue that theory, but I don't know if it's right. But I think that's what Edge of Tomorrow, definitely check that out. I think Gambit just got a great director, and I think it just edged up, and for me, a couple of notches of wanting to see it. Because when they first announced it, I was like, I might see it. I'm sure I'll see it. I just wasn't excited to see it. Then they got the Apes director. I was like, all right, cool. Wyatt was doing it. All right. I'll definitely be seeing it now. Then he dropped out. Then it also, when he dropped out, and then I heard it had a $150 million budget, and I was like, a Gambit movie? I'm like, all right, well, it better be good, you know?
If we're going to start seeing world-class filmmakers take on these, I mean, unlike what Marvel's doing, they're bringing in new blood to direct their films. But now if we get world-class filmmakers, whether it's Bryan Singer, I think they're taking a cue to bring in a guy like Doug Liman to do Gambit is a huge... It's great for us, the viewers, because we're going to get an awesome, really great, well-made movie. I mean, somebody's going to take it really seriously. Doug Liman's, I think, going to knock it out of the park, and we're going to get a hell of a Gambit film.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess they're already building sets for Gambit, so they really actually need someone to be getting on set to, you know, make this film.
Right.
Let's go to something I love to call flashback. This week, we are going to talk about an incredible film called Superman 3.
Yes.
When I think of Superman, I never thought about Richard Pryor. I still don't. When I think about Richard Pryor, I think about Live on the Sunset Strip. Anyway, the fake director of Superman 2 revealed his real inability to direct a Superman film without using most of Richard Donner's directed material. Yes, Richard Lester, here comes the living abortion called Superman 3. This film really sucks on so many levels. It's a challenge to watch now. It's almost as bad as Superman 4 or The Quest for Peace, which is the big winner of all-time Superman suckage. Let's talk for a little bit about Superman 3. I've already said what I thought. What do you think, John Campea?
Look, there is so much awesomely bad footage in this movie. Like, we were talking the other day, there's a couple things that stand out to me the most. Even as a kid who doesn't really understand what's going on, even as a kid, remember that scene when the computer started to wrap up Superman and all of its internal wiring? Even as a kid, I'm like, they're just wires, and that's Superman. How are wires holding him together? And this copper wiring, folks. Then, of course, drunk Superman said, where's your mother? Like, basically. And, like, for some reason, when Superman is intoxicated by the oddly colored kryptonite, the fabric in his super suit goes gray, too.
Right, he's purpley.
I remember thinking, what the hell is this? Why is him getting affected by this, changing the color of his costume? I don't get it. The villains were awful. They tried to do a Lex Luthor-like villain, and it totally failed. They even tried to have the female sidekick thing, too. That didn't work. You got great actors. There was the original guy from The Man from Uncle.
Robert Vaughn.
He was a great actor.
Yeah, Vaughn, who's great. And that, I still remember the one line from it. I've never wear the same pair of socks twice. We donate. What happens to the one you wore? I donate them to charity. And you'd think, look, Richard Pryor is one of the all-time greats ever in the history of comedy.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean he's a fit for a superhero movie. And them trying to merge, I don't know if they're trying to make their own 48 hours out of that with their own Nick Nolte and their own Eddie Murphy or something. I don't know what they were thinking, but it...
I think you nailed it. They weren't thinking.
They were not thinking on this movie at all.
But this is the time when I should point out that Hot Toys did make a figure, a six-scale figure of drunk Superman. and you can, but, you know, and also, let me just talk about the fact that Richard Pryor's character skis off the side of a building.
Right.
How does that happen? They build a ski mountain on the top of a building, and he skis off.
Oh,
of it.
That's right.
Yeah. I remember
and
that.
He said snow on it.
I mean, I don't get skiing in the new Bond film that takes place up in the mountains of wherever. There's no skiing in the new Bond film, but there is skiing in Superman 3.
Yes.
I'd just like to point that out.
Let me point out a few things that still irritate me, that irritated me back when I was a small child watching it. They had the sequence where they're like, fire those missiles at Superman, and it cut to an Atari, like, side-scrolling game graphic. It was like, that's, once again, the amazing comedic talent of Richard Lester. And then we have a 20-minute incredibly boring sequence. It's in the, like, right there. You could see Superman, like, holding back a beam that's lasering his arm, and then he gets a like caught up in some kind of plastic garbage bag for 20 minutes. I remember counting the whole sequence of non-action starting from him coming into that cave after the Atari missile sequence is almost 20 minutes. I think it's 18 minutes and 43 seconds before he gets wrapped up by the copper wires that you hate.
Well, this, you know, Richard Lester is a guy, he directed a very famous Beatles movie.
Yeah,
he did the Three and Four Musketeers.
Yes.
He did bring a light touch, a deft touch to a lot of his earlier films.
Mm-hmm.
This movie made me realize that adults hate children, ultimately. They think we're stupid. They're pandering to us. They're like, oh, we have to dumb everything down for the family audience. When did this happen? It happened with Superman 3. They've been doing it ever since. They treat kids. They condescend to us. We're still big kids deep down inside. We like smart movies. Kids like things that are smart. So why do you have to make stupid stuff for kids? Superman 3, perfect example of how you treat kids horribly and how it's ruined the youth. I won't. It's just
a shame is that it came on the heels of, to this day, one of the greatest comic book superhero movies ever in Superman 2.
Right.
And you followed it up with Superman 3. And then compounded the problem with Superman 4.
Well, it just shows you the Sal Kinds didn't really know what they even had when they had Richard Donner directing the first Superman 2, or the first Superman, which he was shooting Superman 1 and 2 at the same time. And then they had his assistant, who was Richard Lester, kind of steal the job from him to finish the other 30% of shooting Superman 2. So that's why if you see the Superman 2 2006 Richard Donner cut, it doesn't have all, he cut out all of Richard Lester's stuff, but he didn't have anything to replace it with. So there's like screen tests, and the best he could do was the spinning around the world thing as far as for the ending. It's still a better film in my eyes than the Superman 2 that I still like some of the sequences that were in there because they're there from when I was a kid. So they're like bonded into my kid nostalgia brain. But ultimately, Superman 3 proves a lot of things. It proves that the Sal Kinds didn't know what they were doing, and also proves that Richard Lester is a good comedic director. I like his Help stuff, but him handling Superman was just a mistake. Like,
also, it's not treating, if you look at the first 30 minutes of Donner's Superman the movie, it's so mythic.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about America. It's basically the first 30 minutes of Superman is how I felt as a kid when I would read comic books. I took them very, very seriously, and I still do. And they meant something to me. And there's this weird idea. There used to be. It's changed now with things like the Marvel Cinematic Universe, that somehow comic book characters have to be treated as not as important or not as realistic as other characters were, and yet the first 30 minutes of Donner's Superman nails it. I mean, that's why I read comic books when I was a kid. I felt that way about all comics that I felt when I was watching the first 30 minutes of Superman, the movie, back in 78.
Well, there was a thing that in the 80s and even in the early 90s that a lot of writers and directors were embarrassed to have to, I got a sign doing the superhero thing, and they made it really jokey and corny because they never had read comics in the first place, so they didn't understand why people who read comics were even into them.
Right.
And it was never as like a jokey comic, like making fun of stuff. Like Superman 3 begins with like this Rube Goldberg sequence, which is like so out of place.
Yeah.
There's so many bad decisions that you're like, just don't let those people in charge be in charge of comic book movies. Let people actually understand movies who are actually into comics for the right reasons be in charge. And that's why we're in this golden age of comic book movies now, because we've gotten so many of those people in the right job positions now where they're actually making the right decisions. So, and that those decisions are crossing over to people who didn't even read comics and they're enjoying.
Well, look at
Captain
people love
America
The Flash.
Yeah, that's
what
I mean.
What a crossover show The Flash has been for people that didn't even like, they don't know what the Speed Force is until now.
Right.
They didn't know about the Rogues Gallery, and yet they're seeing these shows and they're
I'm
loving
them. I'm not
sure
the CW knows what the Speed Force is, but they're making a great show in spite of that anyway.
But yeah. It's great. We live in interesting times.
So check out Superman 3 and have a laugh. Spotlight time. It's the Goon. Let's talk about the Goon. This is Eric Powell. He's created.
We're not talking about the hockey movie.
No, this is which I like that movie too. That was actually fun. Of all the sports type of movies that I've watched, that was actually a really fun and well done movie. But we are actually talking about the comic book The Goon, and it's written, created, and drawn by the incredible Eric Powell. He's created an incredible universe filled with ghouls, monsters, zombies, robots, demons, and it's all populated inside this crazy town. But you want to stay away from this guy right there, that picture of him, the Goon, because you'll be sorry if you mess with him. This comic is just straight up incredible. It's the art is amazing. It's fun. The writing, it's comedic. It's grittily violent. It's being developed as an animated movie through this company Blur. They ran a Kickstarter. And so they're still working on. I know they've got an animatic and you know.
Wasn't David Fincher involved?
David Fincher was involved, and I believe he's still involved in like some kind of producing capacity. I would love to see this 3D animated version of the Goon made, but I also feel that doing a live action version of the Goon isn't far off, or even doing an animated television series. Now, I'd love to see this movie. I don't know where it's at this point. I supported the Kickstarter when they did it. I'm friends with Eric Powell. We actually did a Death Clock versus the Goon comic book crossover a few years back. And then when I wrote the Death Clock comics proper, Eric Powell did a couple of covers for it. He did a Roxo the Clown cover. So I'm a pal of Eric's, and I'm definitely a big supporter of him and all of his projects, the Goon being one of the highlights, and it's still not there yet. I'd love someone to just take a look at this property. Are you guys familiar with the Goon?
I've actually never read The Goon, but I have a few issues of the comic.
Right on.
I think like the first, was it a miniseries first?
It was.
Yeah, I have the first miniseries, which I haven't read. I'm going to read it because you told me to.
Yeah,
I'm
definitely.
I'm sweaty about it.
I didn't know there was anything beyond the first miniseries. I thought it was just the first miniseries.
Oh, is it?
No. It's a full, like there's about 47 issues
I didn't
now.
Even know that. I thought yeah. It was just, okay.
Let me give you one comic to check out that will turn you onto The Goon. It's called Chinatown. And it's kind of a prequel to what the Goon is now, but all you need to do is read that, and it gives you a setting of why the Goon is who the Goon is, and then you're gonna want to read the rest of the Goon. So check out Chinatown. It's written by Eric Powell. You can buy it anywhere on Amazon. Get a Comixology digital copy. I would get the hardcover. It's the one I have. It's extra sweaty. So check that out. We're gonna move on and rock the Twitter questions. Starting with number one, Nuno. Asks, will James Howlett die in the next Wolverine movie? If so, which would you prefer, an Old Man Logan or a Death of Wolverine movie? So, like I've said before, I want Old Man Logan. I know you're not going to get all those Marvel characters crammed in there due to the Fox, Marvel, whatever, you know. But look, you can replace every single one of those Marvel characters with a mutant character that Fox owns, because they only own like 183 of them. So they own all. Anybody who's ever said, I'm a mutant, can be in the Wolverine movie. So what do you think?
I'm Old Man Logan all the way. I mean, I love that storyline. I thought it was great. I mean, I don't want to. I think that the idea of a wasteland and Logan surviving what a post-apocalyptic,
sure.
I thought that was great. You know, it's kind of Mad Max meets an X-Men movie.
Yeah, totally. It's a great summation of it.
I just don't know. I'm still struggling. How do you do an Old Man Logan movie without Banner and without the Banner family? It's it's not just that, because you can replace elements, but they're like Hawkeye is a key character in that as well. There's a lot of characters, key characters in there. You can replace them out. Like we talked about the other stories, though, I think this is going to be one where they may even call Old Man Logan, but I don't think it's going to look much like the comic book Old Man Logan. I think it'll be, they'll call it that. Days of Future Past was called Days of Future Past. Right.
But it was not Days of Future
Past.
Very
unlike the comic book. I think they'll probably do the same thing here.
I agree, and I like that, because I really enjoy it when they do pluck little elements. Like
I
you were
do
saying,
too.
Thor, even if they change it or call it a Planet Hulk, it's not going to be Planet Hulk.
Yeah, because we talked about this before. A lot of times comic book fans think that the first priority of the studio should be make that movie as faithful to the comic as possible. And we keep saying, no, this is a different medium. Your first responsibility as a studio is to make the best movie possible. Mm-hmm. And look what you got. Captain America Winter Soldier, nothing like Winter Soldier in the comic book, but it was a great movie. Days of Future Past was nothing like the comic book, but it was a great movie. If they can do that with Old Man Logan, like you were saying, cherry pick some of those elements out, make a great movie out of it, thumbs up.
And then we ultimately win because we get a great synthesis of like, there's no way you can, like, if you know what anything about the Winter Soldier, that storyline takes place between three omnibuses.
Yeah. Right.
There's no way to even cover one third of the first omnibus. So you have to make those sacrifices. You have to kind of like, that's, I'm sure all the writers, like, we read everything. We decided to take these three scenes and synthesize them into this, and this. So it's funny
say that. I'm actually in the middle of the omnibus of the trial of Captain America. And I love Brubaker's work. Right? I highly recommend it. That was a great, those are three omnibuses worth getting.
They certainly are. Brubaker is the man.
He is the man.
And if you're not reading Criminal, or if you haven't checked out The Fade Out, check out that comic book, The Fade Out. It's incredible. Victor Grabiel. I think I just murdered your name. Grable. Victor Grable says, hey, why do the filmmakers feel like they have to use old villains from comics and movies? Why never create some new ones? Well, Victor, because most of those villains in comic books are awesome. I mean, I think, it'd be weird, a little bit weird if, like, you had Captain America, the first Avenger, fighting the Crimson Scribbly, instead of the Red Skull.
I want to see the adventures of the Crimson Scribbly, personally. That's just me.
But I think,
what is a Scribbly?
A Scribbly is a very dangerous crab creature. Let's not get into it. But so look at it this way. Everyone's crying about Fox. They still have Dr. Doom and Galactus. Look, Marvel proper with Disney, I could give you a list of 100 villains, not right now on the show, but eventually I will. I'll write them all down for you. One of them's MODOK. But there are so many villains that Marvel owns that they haven't used yet. I'm not worried about a shortage of the villains. What I'm worried about is the execution of the villains, the style of how they bring those villains out, which for myself personally, Malekith was done a little disservice in Thor: The Dark World. He should have been a stronger villain, because he is a stronger villain, the way he was given his screen time. And I understand that had to be push and pull a little bit movie. But
John, I think that the villains are just as much fun as the heroes.
Yes.
So why wouldn't you want to have, like, if you do an X-Men movie, you can't not have Magneto in it. You have to go back. I mean, he's the classic, the whole purpose of the Xavier Magneto thing is two sides of the same. When I saw Brian's first movie, the first X-Men, when you see that scene in the beginning when... Mm-hmm. Are you in my head, Charles? Just when they're just talking. It's two dudes talking.
Awesome.
And you're like, this is exactly.
Awesome.
You're going, this is so good. And that's what you want to see. And if you didn't get a Marvel villain, it would be just as disappointing as not getting a Marvel hero.
Yes.
Or a DC villain.
So the yin and yang.
But here's the problem. This is where people, and I think comic book fans and comic movie fans like all of us, this is where we get it wrong. Okay, if we look at the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I love the Marvel Cinematic Universe, but I think we all agree one of their weak points has been, Loki aside maybe, and maybe aside from Red Skull, is their villains. They're a little bit weak on the villains. And think, if we had, though, Doctor Doom in the Marvel Cinematic, then it would be a great villain. No, it wouldn't. You know why? Because it's not about what comic book villain they're taking using in the movie. It's about how their writers are using their villains. They've had some magnificent villains in the films, but the Marvel Cinematic Universe right now seems to have a philosophy that we want our heroes to be the ones that shine. That's why you have Ant-Man, where Yellowjacket was kind of a throwaway villain. You had a lot of these Marvel films with a throwaway, but it's okay because the movie still ends up being awesome. They want their focus to be on the hero. So let's say, for argument's sake, Marvel had Doctor Doom, and they decided to use as the villain in Ant-Man, for whatever inexplicable reason, they wanted to use Doctor Doom. Guess what? It still would have been the same movie. You still would have had a villain. It's just this time it's Doctor Doom, and he would have been used the same way. They wouldn't have given him any more screen time because they wanted the emphasis to be on Ant-Man. So it's not about which comic book villain do they take and use that will make it good. It's about how do the writers and the producers and the director want to use whatever that villain is. And until that changes, it don't matter if they've got Galactus or Doom or anybody else. It's going to be the same thing. So it's not about which character they got. It's about how they choose and their philosophy of using those villains.
I agree. And I think, there's the point within the some people are complaining like, the Marvel villains are weak because of, but Loki stands out. It's because they're not giving those villains enough, not screen time, but just enough of the weight and gravitas that those villains need. I think Malekith as the dark elf
could have
ruler,
been awesome.
Yeah, Eccleston, who's an incredible actor,
yes.
He wasn't given anything to do except walk from A to B and now say go and do this. He wasn't given the why are the elves so angry? You need to have the reason to empathize with the villain more so even sometimes than the hero, so that you care about the outcome of the thing.
Well, also, but they're also rotating their villains out with each movie, as opposed to the X-Men movies where they've kept Magneto as a presence throughout.
Right.
He's as much of a main character as Xavier or Wolverine is.
Yes.
And if you look at things like, I mean, I loved the Red Skull in First Avenger. I mean, Hugo Weaving was great as the Red Skull, but, you know, then he's gone. Like, you bring the Red Skull back and it doesn't really work anymore, because then it doesn't work.
Well, it might work if he's holding the cosmic cube.
Well, that's true.
Bing.
Yeah, but I
like look
that.
The Winter Soldier. I mean, I know they're going to turn him kind of into a good guy, and he ends up becoming Captain America at one point. But he was a badass villain in Winter Soldier. I mean, what he did to Nick Fury, and I mean, he would kill you.
Yes,
he was the scariest of the Marvel villains. I thought.
Yeah, without a doubt.
And then Thanos, you know. Finally, we're going to
there's
get
things
some.
You do, but here's the thing. The way the comic books are using the villains right now is the same way, because we were talking about Star Wars earlier, the same way J.J. Abrams used a great actor, Eric Bana, as Nero, as the villain in the first Star Trek film he did. That villain is so empty.
Right.
It's just, oh, I'm bad, and I'm angry.
And he's stupid. He travels back through time, and he's like, wow, I'm mad because my planet was destroyed. Well, you've traveled back through time. Perhaps you should go to your home planet and warn them.
And make
so
sure you
don't die.
Them. No, I'm pissed off. So
what? Dumbest villain ever.
The thing is, JJ didn't want the villain to be the story. JJ just wanted the villain to be the plot device that motivates and moves his main characters and his heroes.
Right.
That's what he was there for. So he was underutilized, underused, but it's still made for a great movie. And that's exactly where we are in a lot of the comic book movies today with how they use their villains.
I agree. We're down to the last two questions, and we're going to take a few live questions, and then we're out. So check it out. Hespy has a question. With Captain Marvel pushed back a couple of months, do you think they will introduce her perhaps in an earlier movie? Like an earlier movie like Avengers Infinity War 1?
Well, they were going to introduce her. They said they were going to introduce her in Age of Ultron. You know, and then they
Well, they had that little spot that originally, then I believe Scarlet Witch ended up they were replaced her with. But I mean, is she going to show up maybe in Civil War, or is she going to show up in Black Panther?
I think so.
Okay.
I mean, I think that their modus operandi has been to do that. And I thought Anthony Mackie's appearance in Ant-Man was great, even though we'd already met him.
Right.
But it was great that they put him in there. Why wouldn't they? Aren't we getting Black Panther and Civil War?
Yeah, actually, Black Panther got moved up a few months because they added Ant-Man and the Wasp.
They originally moved it back, and then they moved it up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which is, I'm excited. Like, I've been waiting for a Black Panther forever movie. So it's like good to, all right, they moved it back because of Spider-Man. I was angry. Now they moved it back up a few months.
I just like the fact that Wakanda is going to be a real place now.
It already is. Remember, they were in Wakanda in Age of Ultron. We've already met the guy who's going to become Claw.
Oh, I love that.
So it's pretty fantastic. All right, let's move on to the sweaty question of the week. John, did you want to chime in about Captain Marvel? You think she's going to show up before her own movie?
I think it's a given she's going to show up before her own movie. Absolutely.
And Infinity Wars comes out before Captain Marvel.
Yes, it does.
So she'll definitely be in that. You're right. That's going to be her intro, you know, whether they do an origin or not. Sweaty question of the week goes to Richard I don't know how to say your name. Gigante. Collider Heroes with Studios, repackaging classic storylines like Infinity Wars, Days of Future Past, Batman vs. Superman. What's more likely, Kingdom Come or Secret Wars? Robert, what do you think?
That's a very good question. I think the way the DC Universe is looking, we'll see Kingdom Come before we're going to see a Secret Wars, because remember, they've now reinvented what Secret Wars is in a big way. It's very different. The Secret Wars that we're seeing now is very different from the Secret Wars of the mid-80s. And where you had the Beyonder. Although I'd really like to see the Secret Wars 2 Beyonder in his big leisure suit with the big
white
shoulder pads. I'd like to see that. But yeah, I think besides Kingdom Come will be badass. Mm-hmm. That will be the DC Universe's Infinity War.
Yes. What do you think?
I don't think we're ever going to see a Kingdom Come movie. If we do, it'll be an animated one. So I think Secret Wars is much more plausible for them to make, because you have to do a lot of... You got to abandon a lot of stuff in your cinematic universe if you do a Kingdom Come. And I don't think they're ever looking at doing that. So an animated movie, I think, is in the cards probably in the next few years. But I don't think it's going to be live action.
Yeah, I would have to say Secret Wars for me makes sense, just because not only did they change the Infinity Gauntlet to Infinity Wars, Secret Wars is just like, They can do that after they do three or four more films once they launch 2020, 21, 22. Now you got Secret Wars Part 1 and 2, and that is therein a great place to reboot characters. Secret Wars has that they disappear and they come back as a different character. That's what they did in the 80s with the Secret Wars. Remember when they were like, now She-Hulk's part of the Fantastic Four? You're like, what? It's because the thing's off on the Secret Wars. What? What's going on? It's a perfect way to maybe make Robert Downey Jr. go away. And who's wearing the Iron Man suit now? I don't know, but it's a dude from the Secret Wars. It's just, I would see them using that as a kind of a good way to reboot their universe without having to reboot their universe.
I can see that. You guys have convinced me. You're right. Secret Wars before Kingdom Come.
Well, I mean, I agree with John. I think doing an animated Kingdom Come would be incredibly amazing. It's just it's a game over.
Especially if you do it the way that they did The Dark Knight Returns. If you do a Kingdom Come in that style,
right,
that could be really effective.
Right. It's just like the live action. If they're building their universe towards that, they're building their universe towards an end. Because Kingdom Come, the way it is kind of ends everybody.
Well, you know? But like they would adapt the storyline. You know, it would be like these young usurpers to the throne.
Sure.
And it would basically be another Justice League movie. You change it around, but the storyline could be the same. I mean, I'd love to see Superman and Shazam go at each other.
I agree 100%.
It would
be so amazing.
You don't need Kingdom Come to do that.
Yeah.
No, can do that in other ways.
But that storyline, though, was kind of cool. Like you could leave Superman. He's trying to fix Kansas or Smallville, mm-hmm. you know, and he's exiled himself and they got to bring him back. And that storyline could work if it was rejiggered a bit. It doesn't have to be an end.
You're right. It doesn't.
Be a Justice League
they
movie.
Could do exactly what Marvel does and just pick and choose a few elements from even the earlier Kingdom Comes with Magog and all those characters.
Right.
They could actually do that. And I would love to see that. But personally, I would love to see them put their, you know, every animator they have who's worth their salt to do the Kingdom Come movie. That would be pretty cool. They're never going to be able to get that Alex Ross painted look, though.
No.
So that's kind of the one thing where you're like, oh, look at this incredible, amazing artwork that changed comic books. Like, Alex Ross is one of those people who, like, he's like one of the major players of the art defined an entire generation, and it's still defining it. So yeah. I don't want to see it done in a DC animated style, personally.
Interesting.
I really want to see it like played out live. Maybe it could be an Elseworlds special where you get all these other people like, look, we've got our normal Batman and Superman, but you know, Ben Affleck's Batman, but in this Kingdom Come version, it's Clint Eastwood. What? He can't be. He's 80, I know, but someone who's older. So it could be really fun to do that. Like, hey, we're doing a 4-part Kingdom Come special, you know, for all you know, it could work.
Maybe the CW could do it.
Bam. You really could. It could be like, you know, Flash just introduced Earth 2. And you know how many other Earths there are? It's like a lot. So that could happen. So that's it for our questions. Do we have any on the live stream going on?
Yeah, we got a couple of a bunch of you guys have sent in some questions to me via Twitter in the live stream. We got one from Abdul Muhammin, and Abdul writes and asks, hey, Jessica Jones is getting some great buzz. What are your thoughts?
My thoughts on Jessica Jones, I cannot wait to see that. They showed the pilot at the New York Comic Con, and everyone flipped out. Everyone said it's incredible. It's just as good, if not better, than Daredevil. So I don't know about that. But I'm really excited to see. I mean, I think everything that the Netflix Marvel Union is doing is great. And I love that they're keeping it isolated to a certain degree while saying, hey, look, there's the Avengers skyline. It's in the, you know, this happens. The Hell's Kitchen, that happened, you know, the Avengers movie, the, you know, the aliens and whatnot. But they're keeping it real. They're keeping it all in that same world. So I think Jessica Jones, just those few previews I've seen are like, I can't wait to see this, you know.
I love the Alias comic. You know, it was a
Brian Bendis.
One of their adults, the Max line, and the way they use Purple Man. I mean, a really scary, scary villain. And it was really well used in that series. And they've kind of based it on that,
right?
What they were doing.
David
there.
Tennant is playing the Purple Man.
I know. What casting.
Yeah.
It's going to be great. I can't wait. I mean, look, I think what you just said is great. If they're going to do a Moon Knight series, I mean, how awesome would that be?
Yeah, that's all rumored. I was able to scrimp onto the Luke Cage set, you know, through a little special magic fairy. So I was able to see some cool sets. It looks fantastic. So, I mean, I think everything
they're
doing
is great. Are they going to spin him out of the Jessica Jones series?
Oh, yeah. He's actually in the Jessica Jones series. They're kind of an item.
Yeah, they're
and then
he
gets his own series. They're shooting that right now.
That's so great.
Yeah.
I absolutely couldn't care less about the Jessica Jones series. Now, I'm just being honest. There's nothing about it that has appealed to me so far. Now, with that being said, keep this in mind too. I was not at all excited about Daredevil either until I saw it.
Right.
And then it was like, ah, yes, this is awesome. And so while I right now nothing is clicking with me as far as being excited about Jessica Jones, who cares about that? The big question is going to be, what am I going to be thinking after I watch that first episode?
Mm-hmm.
And because remember, I didn't care less about a Daredevil TV show at the time. And all of a sudden, I think it's the second best, you know, comic book show on television, right behind The Flash. So we'll see what happens once I finally get my chance to watch it.
Have you seen the trailers for it or any of those previews?
I saw a couple of the previews, none of the full trailers yet. And it's where, I just looked at it and went, I don't see anything special here. Or
no, but had you read the Alias comics?
I did not read the Alias comics, though.
Let's get another question.
Okay, I knew I had one here somewhere. Where did it go? I got an awful lot of tweets that have come in while we were doing this, even after we started doing the show. Okay, Martin Stegheimer writes in and asks the question, if Batman can actually beat Superman in Batman versus Superman, then where does the sense of logic go? I got to admit that he's basically asking, what are they doing to their world and their universe if they say a mortal man can beat Superman? How do they do that while explaining it? Let's assume it's not kryptonite, but it's probably kryptonite, right. I'm thinking. That's how you keep your balance of reality, I guess. Yeah. But I don't know. How do you think they're going to handle it?
I think it's great. I mean, they're making Superman not a god. They're bringing Superman down to a human level and making him not like the unbeatable force. I mean, Batman being a human like us and having to fight someone who is in all senses a god is perhaps given that here's a, you know, a little something from Lex Luthor. You might want to use that because it makes him weak. So it brings it down to like maybe it's just two guys fighting. So it might, you know, even the odds, so to speak. I think it's a great idea.
And I think that is a great idea. It's also logical.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the one. That's a very plausible way to bring Superman down, something from his home planet that's irradiated. That is his weakness. I mean, how great was it when you read the original Dark Knight Returns when Green Arrow shows up with the kryptonite arrow?
So good. Oh, yeah. And he's like, this is for my arm because Superman did something to his arm.
He's only got one arm and you know, he comes and uses his mouth to fire the arrow.
I love that old version of Green Arrow.
Oh, so good. I mean, it was so good. And I think it makes perfect sense and logical sense.
Yeah,
I mean, from a comic book standpoint and from a suspension of disbelief standpoint, it's absolutely realistic.
Totally. Let's go for what do you want?
I closed my thing down, so I can't pull one out.
Well, next week we'll do more live Twitter questions because we were live this entire time. It's been pretty fantastic. So let's thank our guest, Robert Meyer Burnett, winner of the Geeky Awards, rocking on the Axanar fan film, a complete amazing live action feature film that you just finished doing some effect shots for.
Yes, I have to say for anybody who supported the Axanar or Prelude to Axanar film, I am directing the feature film version, and I am deep into directing the special effects sequences because we shoot live action on January 18th, but by the time we shoot it, I will have most of the space effects sequences finished, which is the opposite of the way most movies work, and that's going to help us make the live action footage even better. And if you want to find out more about it, go to savethefederation.com or klingonvictory.com, and you can find out and see the first scene from the movie that I directed.
Very exciting. I've been practicing my Klingon. Oh, do a fuck.
The Klingons are, that was badass. I mean,
I've been practicing. So, John Campea, where can people find you online?
First of all, you guys can find my new book, which comes out in December. It's called The Pride. Keep your eyes open for that. And you can find me on Facebook and on Twitter. Follow me at John Campea. And as Schnepp was saying, we did this show live today. We're just testing a lot of things out. So do me a favor, in the comments section, let us know if you like the idea of us doing it live, if it hurt, if it helped, if it didn't do anything to your viewing experience. Let me know what you think in the comments section if we should do this again.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was a little more pressure having to do it live because we can't screw up as much as we love to screw up and cause Dennis extra pain. Like, would you mind editing that one morsel out? So we just rocked it live. So hopefully it was fun for you guys. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram just at Jon Schnepp and at TDOSLWH. You can also find me at Stan Lee's Kamikaze next weekend at the Los Angeles Convention Center, where I'll be screening The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, the entire film for the first time at any convention. We're going to be screening it on Saturday, I believe. So check the guide. We're also doing a bunch of cool panels. I'm doing a Beast Mode panel, just all about my directing stuff that I've done for Adult Swim and whatnot.
Beast Mode? Is that about Marshawn Lynch?
Oh, no, I'm just
a Seahawks.
I rocked in a little sports flavor for you.
You threw in a little sports for you. Schnepp, I'm
proud
of you, buddy.
It's actually called Beast Mode. Hey, I'm trying to rock in there. You know what I'm saying? Seahawks fans and whatnot. But I also wanted to pimp our movie talk
panel that we're doing right after the Schmoes Know panel on Sunday. So you want to stay and see the Schmoes Know and all those dudes do their panel on Sunday at Stan Lee's Kamikaze, and then stick around for the Collider Movie Talk panel. It's going to be led by John Campea, and all of the Movie Talk people are all going to be there. So we'll all be on stage, bring a bunch of questions. So.
Sounds good.
Oh, well, that's it for us.
You're the
episode
host.
I know. I was like, hey, I'm throwing it back to myself. Episode 29, that's a wrap. And come back next week. You've been watching Collider Heroes. I'll see you next week.